Tell about who this person is.
Dr. Gonzalez is one of our emergency room doctors at Phoenix Indian Medical Center.
And she's a federal employee?
Correct.
Now you got this guy in room 4 who got his second dose of vaccine on Tuesday, has been short of breath.
And he's got a little myocarditis.
Yes! Oh, this is bullshit.
Now, let's see, you're already myocarditis due to the vaccine.
Right, but now they're not going to blame the vaccine.
Well, and you know what? But he has an obligation to report that, doesn't he?
They are not reporting.
Right.
But they want to show it under the...
Yeah.
Under the mat.
What patient was she referring to?
She was referring to that patient, that 30-something-year-old patient that had congestive heart.
Congestive heart failure. And in that particular patient's case, it was not reported.
No.
But no, I mean, here they are not doing the studies. People that had it, and the people that have been vaccinated, they're not doing any antibody testing.
Super fishy. That it hasn't been done. It hasn't been.
It hasn't been done because the government doesn't want to show that the Trump vaccine is.
The government doesn't want to show that the vaccine is full of.
It's not doing what its purpose was.
May I see your badges? You're Jodi O'Malley, the Department of Health and Human Services. This is the United States government identification. I'm looking at the CDC website. It says that you're required to report adverse events following vaccinations. One of those would be congestive heart failure.
Yeah, it's a huge one.
Were there other instances that they didn't report?
Oh, I've seen dozens of people come in with an adverse reaction.
Yeah, it's really sad. They just come back from surgery, from leave.
So what are we looking at here?
You're looking at me. Transferring her to a higher level of care that could handle her condition.
And this is a colleague at your hospital who got sick.
She didn't want to take it because of her religious beliefs. And she was coerced into taking it.
Why are you choosing to blow the whistle? It's not what a lot of people would do. They're scared, they're afraid. Are you afraid?
I wouldn't necessarily say I'm afraid because my faith lies in God and not man. This is evil at the highest level. You have the FDA, you have the CDC that are both supposed to be protecting us.
Are you afraid they're going to retaliate against you?
Yeah. I'm a federal employee. What other federal employees do you see coming out?
But you put your faith in God.
Amen.
All right, folks, we are back here on WLTH 1370 AM. If I didn't tell you guys at the start of the show, the phone number is 219-885-1371. That phone number again, 219-885-1371. And who you just heard right there was a nurse for the Department of Health and Human Services. Named Jodi O'Malley, who works at the Phoenix Indian Medical Center in Arizona. And she is talking to Project Veritas. I am no fan of Project Veritas. James O'Keefe is not my favorite person in the world. But I will say this, when it comes to some issues, Rev, Project Veritas have been the only ones who have been willing to expose certain things that the corporate mainstream media mm-hmm. wanted to expose. Like when that broadcaster, that anchor woman from ABC, Amy Rohrabach, when she was talking about Jeffrey Epstein.
Mm-hmm.
And Project Veritas actually got one of the employees of ABC to catch Amy Rohrabach talking about how ABC News had the story of Jeffrey Epstein and Bill Clinton on the plane and had victims of Jeffrey Epstein and all this, and that the network itself killed the story.
Mm.
And this kind of became this became kind of a brush fire, but the mainstream corporate media once again buried the story. Now what's really drew me to this story is after the release of this video where you see, you hear, for the audience at home, you hear Miss O'Malley talking to her colleagues, fellow doctors at this hospital, who are talking about the adverse reactions people have to the vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
I went to try to find what people were saying about this nurse, because I know that everything in this, especially about this pandemic, has become politicized. Right. Everything is politicized. And I went to see how many people were attacking her. And I could not find anybody who was saying, oh, she's not really a nurse. She's not really working there. That's not really her. You know, she's over, like we covered the ivermectin story last week when you were gone,
uh-huh.
about how a guy who didn't even work at the hospital in Oklahoma was saying that people were overdosing on ivermectin. And the mainstream media, MSNBC, Rolling Stone magazine, CNN, all ran with this story. They found out that the guy didn't even work at the hospital, who was claiming to be a doctor at the hospital. Now, nobody is saying this about Miss O'Malley. They're pretty much ignoring. They're just ignoring the story.
Okay.
And so, exactly. So that's a big part of the reason why I definitely thought this was an important story. Let me give some context to the people at home, Rev. I want to hear what your thoughts are about this. So Miss O'Malley recorded several of her colleagues discussing the concern about the harmful reactions to the COVID vaccine during their work at the hospital. Dr. Maria Gonzalez, an emergency physician, expressed the problem here is that they are not doing the studies. People that had COVID-19 and the people that have been vaccinated, they're not doing any antibody testing. The video then records the exchange between O'Malley and Gonzalez about a vaccinated patient who later ended up with myocarditis. In a later dialogue, Ms. O'Malley, just what you just heard, explained that she saw dozens of cases of adverse reaction to the vaccine that went unreported. You know, in this context, Dr. Dale McGee, who's an ER physician, clarified it is not that it hasn't been done, it just hasn't been published. That's what the response was. And the other doctor, Dr. Gonzalez, replied to him, it hasn't been done because the government doesn't want to show that this darn vaccine is full of bleep. Mm-hmm. Now, another Health and Human Services registered nurse, Deanna Paris, told O'Malley, it's a shame that the government are not treating people with COVID like they are supposed to, like they should. I think they want people to die. And so you heard Miss O'Malley say that it is more important for her to get the truth out than it is for people, than it is to keep her job. Now, once again, it is Project Veritas. So take a lot of it, but take some, it is obviously an agenda behind it. They are a right-wing attack dog group, but so the mainstream corporate media is a corporate attack dog group, a corporate liberal attack dog group. So, hey, to me, as far as I'm concerned, they cancel each other out in a lot of ways. What did you think about this story, Rev, when you saw it?
Well, first, I have to admit, I didn't see it.
Okay.
And wasn't familiar with it until you exposed it. It seems like Project Veritas's name is familiar to me for some reason, and I can't.
Well, they're pretty notorious. Like I said, they were behind leaking the Jeffrey, the Amy right, Roback.
Yeah, that neither of those.
And they were the ones behind the guy who's actually talking to Miss O'Malley dressed up like a pimp,
uh-huh.
and took his colleague to a hospital pretending mm-hmm. that he was her pimp and to try to get an abortion or something.
Okay.
So yeah, like I said, Project Veritas are definitely a right wing attack group. There is no doubt about that. Like I said, I'm not a huge fan. But, like I said, I'm not a fan of the corporate media that yeah. lies in the government either. So, like right. I said, they all kind of cancel each other out. I'm looking at Miss O'Malley and right. her credentials
now,
here's and what
the thing.
She has to say.
Here's the thing on that one. I can right now, you played that audio, and I can tell you right now, there are people who would hear that and would dismiss it,
yep.
would say it's just anecdotal,
right.
says, but the science says... You know, I'm not going to follow some crackpot. Everybody that says something other than the national narrative, the federal narrative, is smeared.
Right.
Now, the other thing about it, in the previous story about, you know, the Haitian migrant, this federal law thing, it sounds to me like they could use that law for a whole lot more than just removing illegal immigrants.
Oh, right. Yeah.
That in extraordinary health crises, the federal government can do a lot of things.
Yeah.
Like force vaccinations.
Maybe.
Like round up people who refuse to be vaccinated.
Yeah.
Like require people to have identification, describing their status. It seems like this rule must break the Constitution in several places.
Absolutely.
And yet, when people desire safety more than liberty, they will surrender their liberty for the feeling of safety.
Right. And that's why you have the whole quote from, I think it was Benjamin Franklin, who said, "Those who are willing to sacrifice freedom for security deserve neither."
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the very famous quote from one of the founding fathers. Now, like I said, I'm not anti-vax. I don't want people to, once again, I have to do this disclaimer every single week because I don't want people to say I'm anti-vax. I'm pro letting people do the research for themselves and take the vaccine if and when they are comfortable with it.
Mm-hmm.
That's it. I am not for forcing people to change, especially adult people, to change their body chemistry, which we know that, you know, drugs and vaccines can have an effect on people. I was looking up the history of the polio vaccine not too long ago, and there were a lot of adverse reactions to the polio vaccine when that came out. It wasn't just smooth sailing the way that it's presented. People were paralyzed by the polio vaccine. When it came out in the 1950s, there was actually a company that had to stop making it because they were making so many people sick and crippling people with their vaccine.
Mm-hmm.
So again, that doesn't mean that the polio vaccine was a bad thing. It doesn't mean that I bet I've been vaccinated for it. I did go to school for 12 years. I took my MMR vaccine just like everybody else did in order to go to the Gary Community School System, the best school system in the world. Yes. So I'm definitely not an anti-vaxxer, but I'm definitely not comfortable with, like you said, Rev, the fact that so many people are just willing to surrender themselves to the state and be like, oh, you know, they just want to stick something in me and alter my body chemistry because Dr. Fauci, a man who has been proven to be a liar over and over and over and over again, and again, Joe Biden, who has proved to be a liar over and over and over and over, and Kamala Harris, a woman who's proven to be a liar over and over and over and over again, say so. These same people were saying when Trump was in office and they were developing these vaccines that they wouldn't take them because they didn't want any vaccine that was developed under Donald Trump. Kamala Harris said it. Joe Biden said, who's going to trust the vaccine? Joy Reid, we just talked about this last week when you were gone, Rev. Nicki Minaj, her beef with Nicki Minaj, she was actually exposed by Nicki Minaj as saying that she didn't want to take the vaccine last year when Trump was in office. So a lot of these people are politicizing, as we talk about on this show, the vaccine. They're politicizing. It's solely about how you feel about Donald Trump or Joe Biden or whoever, as opposed to allowing people to make this decision for themselves. Folks, stop politicizing this vaccine. Rep.
Look, I'm like this. I would love to look back and see how, for example, the polio vaccine, how that rollout was handled.
Mm-hmm.
We know, as you pointed out, when they first started injecting people, it was a rough period at first.
Yeah.
It took a while for them to get all the kinks out, to get all the bugs out, till where today you take a polio shot and it's no big deal. It took them a while to get there. And we're being told we should act like we've already gotten there.
Right.
But we haven't even been studying this thing long enough to know whether we've gotten there. We were told a year ago that getting this vaccine would enable us to get back to normal.
Right.
Here we are a year later. Now we're being told getting the vaccine only means, the most they can say about it is, getting the vaccine means if you get sick, you won't get as sick.
Right.
That's not back to normal.
Right.
It isn't.
It is.
You
not.
Know, there's still the factor of, okay, well, what about the people who actually get the disease? Do they actually get immunity? And if so, you know, for how long? For most of us who've gotten the Pfizer, no, the Johnson & Johnson or the Moderna shots, I believe, those are our DNA.
Right.
The other one, the Pfizer one, I believe was actually a traditional vaccine.
Right.
Where attenuated virus cells are actually injected in you. Now, that one works the way the traditional vaccine works. You inject a dead virus in your body and your body's defense systems learn to fight the virus. Mm-hmm. The other ones, it doesn't do that. It deals on the level of RNA and getting them to, I believe it puts a replacement spike. You know, the spike that's on the COVID mm-hmm. cell, it puts a replacement spike. And so the body fights against the spikes. But we don't know what else that will do.
Right.
It's going to take time. Science normally takes time.
Yeah.
You want us to trust the science. Well, the way science normally works, it takes time and observation and repeatability and cross-testing. We haven't been in this game long enough to do the science in order to trust the science.
Right.
Now, if you really mean trust the process, fine. I'm willing to let the process play out and see how it works. I've gotten the Johnson & Johnson shots, the first one and the second one. So I put my body on the line,
right.
But I don't think everybody should. I did it because I had other issues.
Right.
You know, being a pastor, I had issues wanting to be able to visit my elderly congregants if they get sick and go into the hospital, knowing that the way the hospital is playing this, the only way I could make sure that I could go and visit the sick was if I could say I was vaccinated. Now, on a certain level, in other words, I was coerced in it, into it. But I was willing to pay that price. I was willing to make that hit. But I don't think everybody should be forced to. Especially if there are other things we can do to mitigate the risk. Right. If wearing the masks will help mitigate the risk, and they're saying that they will, then fine. Let people wear the mask. If being tested regularly,
right.
and knowing what are the symptoms, for example, you know, how often have you heard it stated that one of the ways you can know that you've been infected is by checking your O2 level? Mm. How often do they tell you that? But last year they were telling people that. So much so that I went and bought myself a watch that monitors my O2 level.
Wow.
And every day I check my O2 level, because if I ever see it get below 96%, I'm going to the hospital to get tested.
Wow.
Because that's one of the signs. At our school, Ascension, we have a temperature monitor, because that's another one of the symptoms. You got a fever.
Right.
So kids come in, if they get a fever, if they're showing a fever, guess what? They're not going to school that day. Now, maybe they don't have COVID. They could have something else. But that's one of the signs that you got COVID,
right.
That you possibly might have COVID, is that you're carrying a fever.
Right.
Do they talk about that now?
No, I haven't even heard that. You're right. I haven't even heard anything about that in a while. We have a call online. But before we go to this caller really quick, I just want to follow up on what I was talking about. In April 1955, about the polio vaccine, after mass polio vaccinations began in the U.S., the Surgeon General began to receive reports of patients who contracted paralytic polio about a week after being vaccinated with the Salk polio vaccine from the Qatar Pharmaceutical Company. with the paralysis limited to the limb the vaccine was injected into. Jesus Christ. The cutter vaccine has been used in vaccinating 200,000 children in the Western and Midwestern United States. Later investigations showed that the cutter vaccine had caused 40,000 cases of polio and killed 10 people. So this is 1955. So when everybody talks about, oh, I mean, the polio vaccine, everything went great. No, not necessarily. It took a while to get the kinks out. Hello, caller.
Hey, Scott, hey, Reverend, how y'all doing today?
We're good, man. How about you?
I'm doing fine, man. You two assholes, wrap it up.
Okay. No, we ain't wrapping it up. We've only just begun.
No, man, we got a whole nother hour left.
Oh, yeah, we just begun.
Yeah.
if you're upset now, you better strap in.
I know, and I think that's a good place to go to our second commercial break. All right, folks, please give us a call, 219-885-1371. And if you didn't hear me this time, hear me again.
You are listening to Scott and the Rev on WLTH 1379. Give us a call, 219-885-1371.